Okay, here we are on week week 10, I think we have, and we have tonight we'll have lecture 19 on the early Germans and Charlemagne, or how dark were the Dark Ages. And then after we have our break, we'll look at Islam. So our first lecture tonight, when we're looking at Germanic Europe, we're looking at early German Europe, and Islam falls right in the middle of our lecture tonight between the first Germanic states and Charlemagne. And so I'll call your attention to that when we do it. The coming of Islam is a huge benchmark in the history of Europe as well as in the Mediterranean. But first we're going to look at the early Germans and as one of the heirs to the Roman Empire. And you remember last time when we looked at the Han Empire in China, and I said there were three heirs to the Han Empire, and we've been comparing the Han Empire in China to the Roman Empire. And as the Roman, as in China, there were three heirs to the Han Empire. In Europe, there were three heirs to the Roman Empire. And you remember that one of the characteristics of the Roman Empire was that it ringed the Mediterranean. It was in a circle around the Mediterranean Sea, and the Mediterranean Sea was the heart of the Roman Empire that connected it all together. Now we have the breaking up of that Mediterranean hegemony. And it's often been said that, in fact, it was Henri Parenne who said that without Mohammed, there would have been no Charlemagne. In other words, he dates the fall of the Roman Empire to the coming of Islam, because Islam, as you see here, cut the Roman Empire in half and cut off that connection around the Mediterranean Sea. And Europe was left high and dry. As you can see here, Europe is the pink area, which is actually where the Carolingian Empire was, and that Europe was a result of the coming of Islam. In other words, that was the parenthesis. So we have two heirs. We have Islam, and we have Europe, and we have the Byzantine Empire, and we've already looked at the Byzantine Empire. It's that green area. Which was a continuation of Rome in a new and more Christian and more Eastern and Greek form. The Byzantine synthesis was Roman and Christian and Greek and Persian, the blending together of Roman and Greek and Middle Eastern elements, which created a third generation civilization, Byzantium. Islam was another new synthesis, another third generation culture that combined Arabic, Roman, Greek, Persian, Mesopotamian, and Indian elements. So it's a new blend of culture, but it's an heir of Rome. The European synthesis that we're going to look at today, at first, was more limited, actually, and the elements that blended together to create Europe as another third-generation culture were Roman and Christian and German. So it was more limited with less elements that combined to make Europe. There were different developments in each of these areas. Each of them used a different language, had a different religion, technology, different ideas about progress, and different ideas about invention and discovery. The status of women was very different in each of the three heirs of Rome, as were attitudes toward work and law and government. As you recall, when we looked at Rome, we looked at the Christian-Roman synthesis, and here we have Rome. This is actually at the time of Justinian, when Justinian tried to reconquer Rome. The Christian-Roman synthesis included the Latin language, Latin social values, religion, the Christian religion, intellectual thought, and the church hierarchy. And these were embodied in the thought of St. Augustine. Remember, we talked about St. Augustine as the height of the Christian theology of Rome in his Confessions and his City of God. And he created the medieval synthesis. It was St. Augustine in both the Confessions and the City of God that created what we call the medieval worldview, the medieval attitudes. For example, the example I gave you was the rape of Lucretia. And remember that the Roman Republic began with the rape of Lucretia, and St. Augustine reinterpreted that event as something shameful for Lucretia, not something she should be proud of, but because she committed suicide, she had actually killed the innocent Lucretia, who had committed no crime at all. And so this was a reinterpretation of all Roman history with Christian values. The Confessions were a personal quest for God, and this represented the new and more personal emphasis of the medieval society. No longer was the state the important thing to pay attention to. No longer was the state the goal of every person's striving and life experience, but rather it's the individual's progress toward God that is more important in the medieval synthesis. Now, Germanic elements were added to this Christian and Roman synthesis. And I want to remind you, too, that we talked about as Rome became more Christian, Christianity became more Roman. And so we have a blending together of those two cultures. Now Germanic elements were added. And you remember the Germans were Indo-European. And so they had elective and limited kingship. They had a warrior assembly. There was a relative absence of slavery, an aristocracy of the king's companions or bodyguard, which were called the comitatus, and a council of elders. In fact, if we look at the basic structure of the Germanic tribes, it's exactly like the early Romans were in the very beginning of their culture. It's a basic Indo-European structure that we have. And now we're going to return to that structure. It's washing over the Roman Empire in a more primitive form and blending together with the old Roman culture. You know, the parallels we might make with this blending together, this repeated infusions of Indo-European culture into Roman culture, you might think of China with those repeated infusions of the nomadic culture of the Huns and the Mongols. Remember the barbarians and the Turks who kept invading China, and that culture would reinfuse it with new values. Well, this was happening to Rome. Stilicho in this picture was a German. And what happened along the Roman borders was the army was stationed along the borders, and there was a shortage of manpower in the Roman Empire. There weren't enough men to fill the army. So what they did was draft the Germans. They brought the Germans into the empire and drafted them into the army. And this became the way to become Romanized. The Germans could become Romanized through the army, and they could climb the social ladder and the professional ladder, and they could become a general in the Roman army and even become emperor. And there were actually German emperors. Stilicho is this person on the right who is dressed as a Roman soldier. He's actually a German who reached the very height of command in the army. And so he was commanding the armies who were fighting against the Germans who were moving into the empire. This is an imaginary picture, of course. It's done in the 19th century. It's not a real picture of what they really look like, but what the 19th century thought. Alaric himself was the leader of the Visigoths who moved into the Roman Empire, largely because of the weakness of the fact that the Romans had to fight the Persians, and so this is one reason that the Germans in the form of the Visigoths moved into the Roman Empire. This is an imaginary picture of Alaric, but it's true that he actually wrote that as he stood before Rome, he said, "I want to become more Roman. I don't want to conquer Rome. I want to become like the Romans." And so his goal was to turn the Visigoths into I wouldn't say citizens, but to adopt the Roman culture. So Alaric expressed that idea. Here we have some pictures of Gallo-Roman soldiers who would have been soldiers who were Gauls, who might have been Germans, who were then in the Roman Empire, as the Roman army absorbed the Germanic elements into it. And here are some Roman soldiers on the left and a Germanic warrior on the right. The Roman army became completely Germanized. For one thing, they adopted trousers to wear instead of these tunics which the soldiers had traditionally worn, and they became more and more Germanic. Notice that the German warrior has a particular cloak. The name of it was Caracalla, and one of the late Roman empires was called Caracalla. That was his nickname because he adopted the Germanic cloak. So as Rome became more Christian, it slowly absorbed German culture, and we're going to see the Germans become more Roman and the Romans become more German. There was that two-way enterprise. Here's a British chariot and arms, and remember that Germans were nomadic. They were horse herders and cattle herders and warriors. They're a warrior society. Here are Saxon farm laborers. Economic conditions went through an important change as the Roman Empire transformed into the Germanic states. Some new institutions arose, what happened was the native Roman, the Roman farmers who had traditionally, the yeoman farmers who had farmed the land, still farmed the land, but they transformed into a new condition. They became what are known as serfs, okay? The rise of manorialism was a new economic system. As the Roman Empire disintegrated, and it really, the government disintegrated, Romans moved into the countryside. They didn't stay in the cities anymore. Remember that Rome was an urban culture, but as the taxes became heavier and heavier, people moved to the countryside, and they lived in the countryside in great villas, and these evolved into the medieval manor. They brought with them their dependents, and these eventually evolved into serfs. And in fact, the Romans brought a lot of slaves. Serfdom was not slavery. It was a semi-free condition in which the serfs were attached to the land, but they had the right to stay with that manor house. They could never be thrown off of the land. They had the right to stay there forever. And so serfs actually had rights. They weren't like slaves, although they evolved from the old Roman word dominus, which means master, and servus, which means slave. These words changed their meaning as time went on, and the dominus became a lord who was not a slave master, but rather he was a participant in a contract in which the serf donated his labor and his time on the land, and the lord granted him the right to remain there forever. And so it's not slavery anymore. And so this is the evolution from Roman villa to medieval manor. And you can see on this diagram what a manor would be like. You have the castle or the manor house. And then everyone who was attached to the manor house, including both the lord and all the serfs, would have a piece of land, and here this is represented by ABCD, which would represent individual people who owned the land. The serfs would live in the village, as you can see here, and it would be self-sufficient. There would be a mill where they would grind their grain, and they might use the mill to saw wood and to process cloth. They shared pastures and untilled land in common. And so this is the typical medieval manor house that we might see. if we talk about the fall of the Roman Empire, most medieval historians agree that it did not fall, that there was an infiltration of the Germans, and they didn't come in very large numbers. Walter Goffert has written one of the key tracts about the transformation of the European world. Germans moved in and settled down side by side with the Romans. There were no great battles. Well, there was one, but there were no other great battles. The Germans did not grab the land. They settled down side by side with the Romans, and they tried to earn money, and they actually bought land from the Romans, and that's how they acquired land. And as the generations went by, there was a lot of intermarriage between them, and it was a pretty peaceful takeover of the Roman Empire. And as we said last time, the Romans pretty much abandoned the land and retreated to Byzantium, to the Eastern Empire. So we have the infiltration of those Germans settling in Spain, and in modern Spain and France and Italy and Germany and in that area. And we also have another transformation going on, which is a Christian transformation, and this is best described by Peter Brown in his book, The Cult of the Saints, in which he talks about a change in mentality, a change in the way people think. Because in the Roman Empire, we saw that people were really grounded in reality, as we saw in photographic art. Now people are focused on the other world. They're focused on the spiritual world, and they see the saints as a link between the real world and the heavenly world to which they aspire. And so this is a great intellectual and mental change in the Roman Empire. Okay. If we look at the geography of Europe, the Germanic kingdoms are in the yellow part here. The key kingdoms are Visigothic Spain, Ostrogothic Italy, Merovingian Gaul, Anglo-Saxon England, and the Kingdom of Burgundy, which is in the Rhone River Valley. The Lombards were in Italy after Belisarius, the Saxons were in Germany, and the Slavs were in Eastern Europe. And so Europe is unified largely by its concentration in the north west side of the Mediterranean. And here we can see a little bit of the geography. We might mention the Alps that separate Italy from France, and there are mountain ranges in France. Notice that England is an island, as are Ireland and Scotland, which are usually taken together as Britain. Notice that Spain has a natural barrier between Spain and France, the Pyrenees Mountains. The Rhine River is a natural barrier between France and Germany, and it's along these lines that the Germanic kingdoms developed. Okay. Just because the Germanic warriors were wanderers and they didn't build cities and they didn't create great monolithic art like huge statues, that doesn't mean that they were ignorant and unskilled and uncivilized. In fact, they specialized in metalwork. They created great works of metalworking, of working in small portable objects, and jewelry, portable boxes, things of that sort. Here we see a reliquary that they created. And here's another example of this Germanic metalwork. Why do you think the Germans excelled in metalwork? What would be, I mean, this is not simple work. This is not primitive barbarian work. This is very refined and sophisticated. And it's just a different kind of work in a different medium. Think about it for a minute. They're cattle herders. They move around. They come from a nomadic culture with jewelry and small metal art of this kind. You can take it with you. Okay, you can travel around with it. If you build cities and great architecture and you build and you make statues, you can't carry them with you. Okay, so because they're nomads, this is the kind of art that they produced. It's sophisticated art. It's difficult art. It's not barbaric and primitive. And as they became converted into Christians, they then applied this metalworking technology, to church artifacts that might be used. Here's a tray that might be used and a chalice using Germanic metalwork to infuse the church with their art styles as they became Christian. Here are the kingdoms I mentioned to you before. The kingdom of the Visigoths, which is orange on this map. There's another Germanic kingdom, the Suevi, in the north of Spain. Burgundians are the pink area in the middle. And the kingdom of the Ostrogoths was the first Gothic kingdom that was there. It actually replaced the Visigoths in that area, and the Visigoths then moved westward into Spain, where they conquered. Okay. The Angles and the Saxons are yellow on that map in England, and we'll come back to them. So here are the Germanic kingdoms: Visigothic Spain, Ostrogothic Italy, Merovingian Gaul. The first phase of Gaul is called Merovingian Gaul, Anglo-Saxon England. The Ostrogoths collapsed fairly quickly and were replaced by the Lombards, fresh and more Germans who moved into that area after Belisarius ravaged the land. The Kingdom of Burgundy was in the Rhone Valley, and the Saxons were in Germany. The Gauls and the Visigoths in Spain were the most Romanized because those were early Roman colonies, and Rome had been settled there for a long time. The Germans remained the most primitive because the Romans had never been in their land, and so they didn't have as much of that character. The Merovingians were interesting because, let's go back to this one a minute. Most of the Germans were already Christians by this time. They had been converted as Arians, and the Arians were a heretical sect of the Christian church. They believed that in the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, the Father was greater than the Son. And remember, we talked about that. This is not monotheism. If you have the Father greater than the Son, you don't have three gods in one. It's not a monotheistic religion. This heretical branch of Christianity appealed to the Germans, and missionaries came out, Arian missionaries came out to the Germans and converted them, so that when the Germans moved into the Roman Empire, they were already Christian, but they were heretics. And so this impeded their inclusion in Roman culture because they were heretics. The ones who were not heretics were the Gauls. The Visigoths and the Ostrogoths were Arians. The Gauls remained pagan. And so the Merovingian Gauls saw the advantages of becoming Catholic Christians, and it was Clovis who converted in 511. He was the king of Merovingian Gaul, and he converted to Catholic Christianity, and along with him, 3,000 of his followers were converted and baptized on the same day. And he created the Kingdom of the Franks. Now, in Visigothic Spain and Ostrogothic Italy, the native Romans were very resistant to the German rule because they were under the heretics, the heretic Arians. But in Gaul, this unified the Romans and the Germans, and so it's often said that Gaul or France becomes the heart of the new Germanic territory. The greatest historian of the Gauls is Gregory of Tours, who wrote the History of the Franks and the Frankish Royal Annals that explain the history of Clovis's conversion, and the theme of these stories was the Christianization of all of the Merovingian Gauls. And here are some of the coins that were minted by the Merovingians. We see successive ones, the head of Clovis II above, and you see that the Merovingians were trying to be very Roman, because coining medals with your portrait on it was a Roman thing to do, and so this is what they were doing. Here is the throne of Dagobert, one of these Merovingian kings, and you can see it's very Germanic. It doesn't look very Roman at all, so this would have been the throne. Meanwhile, Christianity was changing drastically in the Roman Empire. Most of the saints had been martyrs who had been killed by the Romans as the Romans persecuted the Christians, and they became the first saints of the Christian church. Now there are no more martyrs because they're not being persecuted by the Roman Empire anymore. The Roman Empire has become Christian, and so where are we going to get saints, and what is their function going to be? As the government broke down, the political unity of the Roman Empire broke down and everything became more local, every local village and town created its own saint. And so they all wanted to have a saint, and so a local holy man would be elevated to sainthood and be given the attributes of a saint, and when he died he would become a saint and a patron of that local village. So the very first saints in medieval Europe were local people who were heroes of local towns, and there was no pope at that time who chose who the saints would be. Just everybody in his own local city would name who would be a saint. So these are some Merovingian saints, and they became the new heroes of the time. The most advanced of these cultures was Visigothic Spain, and think about it a minute. Spain was far more civilized than Gaul was, because it was the first Roman colony, the first Roman province. It was very Romanized, it was very rich, it had an old culture, a lot of trade, and this became the first center of growth of Germanic culture, and we have a kind of little renaissance going on in the Visigothic kingdom. It became the most developed, and the most important of the people in this renaissance were Isidore, Bishop of Seville, who wrote an encyclopedia of all knowledge, and this became a foundational document for all of medieval Europe. His brother was John of Biclarum, and together they wrote a lot of saints' lives and a lot of other literature. The bishops of Spain were very busy writing. Over a period of time, the kings were converted from Arianism, and as each generation went by, the kings became more Catholic, and finally they merged together and were completely Catholic. It was the most brilliant kingdom of the earliest Germanic kingdoms, and I would argue that this was the first of the renaissances that we're going to find in Europe. One of the most important things that were done in Visigothic Spain was the councils of Toledo, and these were great church councils where the great issues of the church were discussed and laws for the church were passed, and then these laws of the councils of Toledo became the most important set of laws for Europe as Europe developed. So the first law codes were developed for the church, and the Visigoths themselves wrote codes of law for the government on the model of Roman law codes, so they adopted a lot of the Roman practices. Ostrogothic Italy, on the other hand, and let's go back to our map really quickly here. Here you can see the orange is the Visigothic kingdom, and the green is Ostrogothic Italy. Let's go back to our text then. Ostrogothic Italy was ruled by Theodoric, who ruled the kingdom just before the Emperor Justinian, and Theodoric was actually a German, but he was raised in Constantinople. He was educated with a Roman education, and when he went to Rome to become the king of Ostrogothic Italy, he ruled according to Roman laws and Roman customs. He still had the Senate meeting in Rome, and he adopted all of the Roman customs, and he used Roman bureaucrats in carrying out the government. It was exactly like the Roman Empire had been governed, except that Theodoric was a German who was king. He also had a secretary named Cassiodorus, who at first helped him by carrying on the Roman traditions. The important thing that Cassiodorus did was to focus the monasteries on collecting libraries. And so this is the first time that we have the monasteries actually collecting books and great libraries. Boethius lived at Theodoric's court and wrote his consolation of philosophy that became a foundational tract, a foundational writing for medieval Europe. But remember that Justinian's general Belisarius came to and tried to reconquer Italy for the Roman Empire when Justinian tried to reconquer the West and created utter chaos and poverty. He destroyed far more than the Visigoths ever destroyed as they conquered the area. And now Europe was plunged into poverty. It had a manpower shortage. The population declined drastically, and it was the poorest part of the old Roman Empire. And so here you see some Franks who lived in the 8th century in the very poorest part of Europe. Okay. I don't know why this is here. This is a Roman writing of the 5th century that passed into the Germanic culture. Of course, they learned Latin. This would have been the kind of Roman writing that the Merovingians and the Ostrogoths and the Lombards inherited from the Roman Empire. And we have some initials. We have some creativity going on here, even though it seems like the very darkest part of Europe. And so illustration of capital letters is one of the first things that the Merovingians did. The thing about text was literacy declined and texts themselves became sacred. And so this is one reason why they were decorated in this way, because people couldn't read them and they used them as a kind of a holy text which they couldn't read, and so they decorated very ornately. And this is some of the Merovingian decoration. Okay, this is Lombard. Lombard Italy became one of the most important centers. After the Ostrogoths were destroyed by Belisarius, the Lombards moved into Italy. Okay, the Kingdom of the Franks here swiftly degenerated and divided into four important parts. And you can see the four parts of the Kingdom of the Franks: Aquitaine, Burgundy, Neustria, and Austrasia. And so Gaul, or France, was not unified under the Merovingians, but tended to disintegrate into smaller kingdoms. Nevertheless, the whole culture was the culture of the Franks. Here are some of the warriors that would have been the kind of society that would have been in Frankish Gaul. These are Anglo-Saxons. They were also in England. Okay, and here we have our map again of these different areas. Okay. A great change happened in Lombard Italy, and this is largely because of the great poverty and the chaos that was going on, especially in Italy. Gaul was sort of holding together. Spain was the most prosperous and the most organized of all the kingdoms. Lombard Italy was utterly chaotic. And it was in this environment that the great new leaders of Europe actually arose. And these were Saint Benedict of Nursia, who wrote the foundational document of medieval Europe, the Benedictine Rule. And he wrote the Benedictine Rule in the 500s. This is a document that you were supposed to read for today, the Benedictine Rule. It wasn't the only rule, monastic rule, that there was in Europe. There actually were a lot of different rules floating around. The Benedictine Rule replaced them all for a number of different reasons. How many of you have read the Benedictine Rule in your readings? Has anybody read it for today? Okay. What did you think of this rule? Did you think it was an easy way to live? Do you think it was what was your impression of the Benedictine Rule? Would you like to live under it?
I think it seemed a lot more relaxed than some other monasteries.
Good. It was more relaxed. It was moderate. And one of its virtues was, instead of being very strict so that the monks had to starve themselves and live in complete isolation as some of the early monks had done, it supplied sociability. It was a community where people worked together. They were allowed to eat moderate food. They had to pray quite a lot. They had to work quite a lot. But nevertheless, it wasn't so harsh that a normal person couldn't follow the rule. One of the most important, and this moderation was one of the reasons why it was so successful and that it was adopted everywhere. One of its rules was, that was really formative, was laborare est orare. And do we have any Latin scholars in here who can translate what that is? Laborare est orare. Are those words familiar to you at all? No Latin scholars, okay. Laborare means to work, okay. Est is. Orare means to pray. To work is to pray. And what this does is this elevates the common labor of your hands, the kind of work that everybody does. This is equivalent to prayer. So what this does is to sacralize work, work of all kinds. And of course, Jesus was a carpenter himself, so work with your hands was very sacred. And what it did was glorify work and make work sacred so that work becomes a very strong value in European culture. Other values that are praised in the Benedictine rule are chastity, charity, and obedience. Okay, monks were not allowed to marry. They had to live in the communities with other men, and they had to swear that they would never marry or never engage in sexual activity of any kind. Charity means essentially love, giving to the poor, loving your neighbor, loving mankind, loving God. All of these come from the sense of charity. Obedience. They were to be obedient to their abbot and obedient to God. So these are the prime monastic values. The leader of the monastery was the abbess. Abbess is the Hebrew word for father. And so the leader of the monastery was called the abbot. And the monasteries were called abbeys. They were also called monasteries where monks lived. At this very time that Saint Benedict was writing the Benedictine rule, there was utter chaos in Italy, and missionaries came, interestingly, from Ireland. There had been a large settlement of Christians in Ireland. They had been flourishing. The monasteries in Ireland had been flourishing, but they were not Benedictine. They were very different from the Benedictines. They didn't live in cities. There were no cities at all in Ireland. And missionaries came from Ireland to settle in Northern Europe. And the leader of these was St. Columbanus. He was the one who introduced the Irish custom of confession into the Christian church. And he founded monasteries in Northern Europe that suddenly became centers of learning and very thriving. Did the Irish save civilization? Well, maybe in a way. They did, because what I think happened was they stimulated a response from Rome. And the response was from the greatest of these early popes and the most important of them, Pope Gregory I the Great, who was actually a monk in some of the first Benedictine monasteries. He was the one who spread the Benedictine rule all over Europe. And part of the success of the rule was not only because it was moderate, but because Gregory chose it as the organizing principle for the church. He took the Benedictine rule and he transformed it into a rule for bishops, for the church as well. And he wrote a book called Pastoral Care that adapted the Benedictine rule to the bureaucratic practices of a bishop. And it's very interesting that the prime function of both the abbot and the bishop is to be a teacher and a physician of the soul, to care for the souls of the people under them. This is St. Gregory the Great, who knew the Benedictine rule and adopted it as the foundational rule for the whole church. He wrote Pastoral Care and he wrote A Life of Saint Benedict, and he is considered the founder of the medieval church. Okay. The book becomes sacred in this time, and so One of the most important things that Gregory the Great, here is Pastoral Care, his handbook for bishops, which I mentioned, the most important thing that St. Augustine did was to organize the resources of Europe and turn northward. He turned the whole culture northward. The story goes that one day he was walking in the markets of Rome and with his friend, and he saw some slaves that were being sold in Rome, and they were beautiful little blonde boys with golden hair. And he said, "Where did those beautiful children come from?" And his friend said, "Well, they come from the north. They are Angles." And in the most terrible pun in history, Pope Gregory said, "Angles, Angles, no, they are angels, and we have to go there and find these wonderful people." So he sent missionaries to England. And England, here is Roman Britain, which had been settled by the Romans, and then when the Roman Empire disintegrated, the Romans left Britain, and actually the Angles and the Saxons took it over. Here is Roman Britain, and here are the Angles and the Saxons, who were Germans. Actually, they were coming from the Scandinavian peninsula of Denmark, and you can see they're sailing to England, and they wiped out Christianity in England. The Angles and the Saxons created a new culture, and it was pagan. It was pagan. And so Gregory sent missionaries to England to convert the English. And here are the Angles and the Saxon settlements that were made in England, the East Saxons and the South Saxons and the East Angles and all these different settlements, the West Saxons, all over England. Okay, the missionary he sent to England was St. Augustine of Canterbury, and he became the missionary who converted Canterbury. He came with a group of monks, and these people were all Benedictine monks, so that they became the bishops of the church in England, and they're very important that they were actually monks founding the Church of England. And so it's this conversion of England. This is an imaginary picture of St. Augustine preaching to King Ethelbert of England, who he converted and founded the Church of England. St. Augustine of Canterbury founded the Church of England. Here is St. Augustine's throne at Canterbury Cathedral, which still to this day is the head of the English Church, where St. Augustine founded it. And here are the St. Augustine Gospels, which become the center of another Renaissance. This is called the Northumbrian Renaissance because these missionaries to Anglo-Saxon England brought with them tons of books, and they brought learning, and they brought teachers, and they infused England with this Roman culture, causing an English Renaissance as the foundation of the English Church. One of these people who went to England was Theodore of Tarsus, who was a Greek, and he brought Greek learning to England, and Canterbury became the center of a great Renaissance, and the collection of a library and the dissemination of learning throughout England. This tended to move northward because from Canterbury, missionaries went all over England, especially to the north. This Renaissance is actually called the Northumbrian Renaissance. And here you see the St. Augustine Gospels, which are very Roman in character, as one of the artifacts of the Northumbrian Renaissance. It blended with Irish culture, and so we have the great masterpieces of the Book of Kells, Irish art, blending together to make the art of the Northumbrian Renaissance. Here are the Lindisfarne Gospels, and the most famous person in the Northumbrian Renaissance is Bede, the great historian, the great English historian Bede, whose History of the English Church tells of the conversion of England and the settlement of Roman culture in England. This is the Lindisfarne Gospels. Canterbury is the center. Here's the Church of Canterbury on the left, and on the right is a document showing the various churches subsidiary to Canterbury as the head of the entire English church. And Canterbury considered it the head of the churches of all of England, and there was a huge building campaign. Churches popped up all over England. They built churches everywhere. Here are the ground plans of some of these churches that were built all over England. Here's a picture of one. Not very many are left, but this is one of the few of the very early churches that the Augustine's missionaries built in England. So here is one of them. They're relatively small, as you can see. They're small churches. And from this great cultural center of England, the Anglo-Saxon missionaries left to go to Germany. They returned to the continent. All of these educated people of the Northumbrian Renaissance moved to the continent. The most important of these English missionaries were St. Boniface, who went to Flanders. Another name for Flanders is Frisia. What is Flanders today? Does anybody know what Flanders is today? It's the Netherlands, yeah. Holland and the Netherlands, that's where Flanders is. St. Willibrord was one of these missionaries, and interestingly, women went along too. His sister Walpurga went. Willibrord and Walpurga went to Germany, and they went to convert the pagan Germans in Saxony and Bavaria. Boniface is also interesting because he came to the Merovingian Franks as a missionary to convert the Merovingians. Because the important thing is, the Merovingians had remained separate from Saint Gregory's missionary forces, and Boniface came as an agent of Rome. The important thing about these missionaries from England were they remained very closely tied to Rome, and France was not tied to Rome. It was very independent under the Merovingians. So Boniface was actually a missionary to the Merovingian Franks, coming from England, representing the papacy. Boniface was the architect of the success of the Carolingians. The Merovingian dynasty fell apart, and the Carolingians took over. Now, how did they do that? The Carolingians took over because they appealed to the Pope of Rome, and it was on the authority of the Pope in Rome that they deposed the Merovingians and replaced them with the Carolingians. Does anybody know who the most important Carolingian king was? Who was the most important of the Carolingians? You know. Charlemagne. Okay, he wasn't the first, but he was the greatest of the Carolingians who then took over. These missionaries were the architects of the papacy, and one could argue that they were the creators of Europe. And think about it for a minute. You could think of Gregory the Great, Gregory the First, as one of the creators of Europe. All this was interrupted by the Islamic conquests of the 600s and the 700s, and we'll talk about that in the second hour. But just look at this map for a minute, and you can see that Islam burst upon the world, and within 100 years they had conquered all of North Africa and all of Persia and Arabia and the East, and conquered even Spain. And you see how they cut off the Mediterranean. Interestingly, Mohammed was exactly contemporary to Pope Gregory the First. They were there at the exact time, and this is the time when Europe may have been created, with the combination of Islam and Pope Gregory turning northward. Now here is Merovingian France, and you can see that it's broken up. It's in four parts. Charlemagne and his ancestors, actually Pepin the Short was the one, was his father, who first took over the Frankish kingdom. They based their power in Austrasia, the yellow area here to the north, and they were Austrasian, and they took over as mayors of the palace. Here's Carolingian cavalry. Here are Carolingians. Charlemagne was the creator of the Carolingian Empire. And I mentioned to you before the parenthesis, without Mohammed there would have been no Charlemagne. Around 700 we see the beginning of the Carolingian rise to power. Pepin of Heristal was the first of the line of mayors of the palace to the Merovingian kings in Austrasia, as I said. Charles the Hammer was his son, and you might have heard that saying in 732 at the Battle of Tours, Charles Martel defeated the Moors. Well, this is a kind of myth that Europeans teach their children. If we looked at the Carolingian Empire, we might see that Europe was the most backward area of the whole area of the world at that time, and I really think the Moors, the Muslims, had no interest in France. Why should they conquer France? It was backward, it was poor, it was poverty-stricken. There was nothing there for them to want. Spain was rich and full of art and literature and wealth. They took Spain. They wanted it. Let's go back to that. So they took Spain. But why bother with France? On the other hand, Persia was bursting with wealth and art and culture for a long time. So why should they bother with Europe when they could conquer Spain first and then Persia, which is what they did? Okay. But the important thing about the Carolingians and Charles Martel was that it's believed that in the time of Charles Martel, the stirrup appeared in Europe. And Lynn White Jr. has argued that the stirrup caused an enormous social change and military change. That because of the stirrup, and you can see these Carolingians, there are stirrups that they're riding with their horses. If you don't have stirrups, you fall off the horse. You can't hold yourself on the horse, which means you can't fight on horseback. And so what Lynn White Jr. argues is that you can have mounted shock combat. You can fight with your lance couched under your arm and gallop forward and fight on horseback. And so he says this is the origin of knighthood and European medieval cavalry. With the discovery, or probably the discovery of the stirrup, it probably came from Central Asia. The other important thing that was done, and here you see these Carolingian soldiers with their stirrups, was castle building. And this happens really at the end of the Carolingian Empire. We see the building of castles for the first time. Castella is a little fort. And one of the things that Charles Martel did was to confiscate all the church lands and distributed them to the warriors. And the results were that later there was a creation of a new aristocracy, mostly the relatives of Charlemagne, taking over the church lands and imposing themselves as an aristocracy over everyone else. Pepin the Short, who ruled from 741 to 768, was the first Carolingian king of the Franks. He was crowned by that English missionary we saw before, Saint Boniface, and he was crowned because Saint Boniface wrote a letter to the Pope in Rome with the question, who ought to rule, he who has the power or he who has the name of power? And the Pope replied, he who has the power. And so they deposed the old Merovingian king. They didn't kill him, much to their credit. They're very Christian, and so they tonsured him, they shaved his head, and bundled him off to a monastery. And that's how they got rid of the king. Later, Pepin the Short was crowned again by Pope Stephen II. The last Merovingian king, as I said, Chilperic, was tonsured and sent off to a monastery. Okay, and here we have castles. Here's the coin of Pepin the Short. I mentioned Charles Martel, the Battle of Tours, and the confiscation of church lands. Okay, in the government of Charlemagne, counts and bishops were equal. Both of them traveled in pairs around the whole Carolingian Empire. Here is one of these Carolingian kings ruling in the center of what we might think of as a castle, a fortification. So here is a Carolingian king, and here is the coronation of Charlemagne. Charlemagne spent his whole life, and let's go back to this, Charlemagne, whose name was Carolus Magnus in Latin. This means Charlemagne, Charles the Great. He conquered the Spanish March and Lombardy and Saxony. And in Saxony, which is Germany, he converted all the Germans at the point of a sword. And he created an empire. We'll see a map of his empire in a moment. But he conquered all of the Frankish lands and all of the German lands and all of the Italian lands, and created what is known as the Carolingian Empire. In 800, he was crowned Roman Emperor by Pope Leo III, and here we have Pope Leo placing the crown on Charlemagne's head. Charlemagne, this was on Christmas Day in the year 800. Later, Charlemagne said if he had known that the Pope was going to crown him emperor on that day, he would never have gone to church. Okay, so what happened was Leo surprised him and popped the crown on his head. So why do you think he would say that? He was already king. Pope Leo crowned him emperor. Why do you think Charlemagne, and I believe that Charlemagne was telling the truth when he said he would never have gone to church that day if he had known that the Pope was going to crown him emperor. Why? Why would Charlemagne say, I don't like this? Why do you think?
Maybe in a way it showed that the Pope was higher than him because he was the one who crowned him.
Exactly, exactly. It's because if the Pope had the power to crown him, then he has the right to choose who is going to be the emperor. What the Pope was doing was trying to recreate the Roman Empire and to recreate the power. Remember that the bishops had over Constantine. He was trying to create a new Constantine, Charlemagne as the new Constantine, but he was trying to assert his right to choose who was going to be the emperor. And so as we go along, there's rivalry between church and state, which is so typical of Europe from this time forward. And the Pope replied, and Charlemagne replied to the Pope in his letters that he wrote to him, okay, it's your job to sit in Rome and pray, and I'll do everything else. I'll run the church, and I'll defend it, and I'll conquer everything. And so that was his attitude toward the church. He supported the church. He was a good Christian, a good Christian king, and he regarded himself as a Christian crusader who ran the church, but he regarded the Pope as peripheral to what he was doing. And here is the Carolingian Empire, which I promised to show you. The green part here in this map is the which is the first European empire, not as big as the Roman Empire, but impressive. And here we have a close-up of the Carolingian Empire unifying most of Europe. Parts of it are not in it. And here is Charlemagne's sword and his sword fittings. Okay. Here is Charlemagne with his vassals, and we see the first appearance of vassals, lords and vassals, the elements that later would become feudalism, which is so characteristic of Europe. Here is a vassal kneeling to Charlemagne. And Charlemagne brought scholars from all over the European world. He brought them all to his capital at Aachen, which was in the north of Europe, and he created the Carolingian Renaissance. Here I have to mention the Oath of Fealty, which is an oath of fealty required of all men in the kingdom. They had to give an oath of loyalty to Charlemagne. Counts and bishops traveled in pairs as missi dominici, messengers of the Lord, all over the kingdom. They issued directives and laws and collected taxes. They received the oaths of fealty and the rules for the church and the churchmen. Counts and vicomtes had miniature governments with their own missi, a miniature government of the king's government, and the counties were like the provinces of the Carolingian Empire. Charlemagne himself governed with capitularies, which were legislation for both church and state. The laws were codified and rewritten for the Saxons, the Franks, the Lombards, and the Burgundians. But these were codes of laws that were each separate for all the different peoples of the empire, so he didn't think of it as a unified empire. One of the most important things he did was to make Aachen, his capital, a center of learning, and he created the Carolingian Renaissance. He gathered scholars from all over Europe, but especially from England. It was the English scholars from that Northumbrian Renaissance that came to Charlemagne's court and were the inspiration for his own Renaissance. This is a manuscript of Charlemagne. We see this explosion of learning, the copying of manuscripts, the collection of books and libraries all over the kingdom. Paul the deacon came from Lombardy. Peter of Pisa came from Pisa. Gottschalk came from Germany. John Scotus Erigena came from Ireland. Agobard of Lyon, Lupus of Ferrières, and Einhard, who wrote A Life of Charlemagne. This is a manuscript of Charlemagne, and actually you can see Charlemagne's signature there in the bottom. Can you see it? It's a monogram that says Carolus, and you can see the K-A-R-O-L-U-S. Here it is again, the signum of Carolus, Emperor Charlemagne's signature. The Carolingian Renaissance was extremely important, and to sort of illustrate it, this is Roman writing. Most of the Roman inscriptions that survive were in stone, and this is a Roman inscription. What do you notice about this inscription? Did anything jump out at you, this inscription? How would you describe it? What is the lettering like? What is the lettering like in the, could you put the inscription on the screen again? Okay, what is the lettering like? All capital letters, right? How about the punctuation? Where's the punctuation? No punctuation. You can't tell where one word ends. You can't tell where one sentence ends. You can't tell where a paragraph, no paragraphs, no capital letters. I mean, it's all capital letters, so this is a Roman inscription. Everything runs into everything else. You can't tell where the sentences begin and end, or the words begin and end. Here's another one, an inscription on the Arch of Constantine, and we see a few little breaks, but it's still all capitals. You can't tell where the words end and where the sentences end. This is on St. Augustine's Bible in England. We saw that Northumbrian Renaissance no punctuation. Now, this is an inscription, an Anglo-Saxon inscription that's developed in the 8th century. All of a sudden, it's changed enormously. We've got some capital letters there. We've got spaces between the word. We've got some punctuation. This was an invention of the Anglo-Saxons because they were writing in a foreign language. They were writing in Latin, and so they had to adapt it. They had to make it easier to read. So what they did was invent capital letters and small letters. They invented spaces between words and punctuation between sentences. And so this is the kind of writing that was transferred from England to the Carolingian Renaissance. And so Charlemagne began a great recopying of books all over the Carolingian Empire, and recopying them in what is called Carolingian minuscule. And this is the writing that they used. Capital letters, small letters. This should make you think of, for example, the masthead on the New York Times. This is the kind of lettering that we see. In the Italian Renaissance, which tried to go back and rescue all the Roman books, the Italian Renaissance thought that this was real Roman writing, and so that's why we use this writing, because they thought that the Romans wrote this way, but it wasn't. It was the Carolingians. The Carolingians invented this script and recopied all the books so that when the Italians read those books, they read them in Carolingian minuscule. Okay. And here's some more, and it's beautiful writing, and it's very easy to read, the Carolingian minuscule. Okay, and compare it again to this kind of Northumbrian script. All right, we see the invention. It's a very creative Renaissance. We see the invention of all of these initials. We saw the Merovingians doing these elaborate initials, and the Carolingians carried it even further, elaborate, beautiful initials in the books, and they become historiated initials with little pictures in them illustrating what's in the text. And here's another of these initials so that you can see little pictures in them. And books change enormously at this time because of the repeated decoration. Here is one of the book covers This is a metal book cover using that wonderful metal work that the Germans are so good at, studded with jewels, and in the center is a sculpturesque crucifix showing Christ on the cross. And these beautiful book covers. This one is ivory in the middle and metal around the outside. And here are some of the pages of these books. This is a calendar, and it's the first calendar that we find in. It's a table of contents, actually, not a calendar. It's a table of contents for the Bible, and shown with a revival of Roman architectural forms that frame this picture. And here we see very Romanizing artwork with very naturalistic animals, but they don't quite get the perspective right. Notice that fountain is very weird looking, that it doesn't look like a real fountain at all, but they're trying to revive Roman art styles and Roman forms in this. And here's another of these manuscripts showing realistic animals, and the animals are the signs of the Gospels, actually. And then we see the depiction of the human body in a very realistic instead of a symbolic form, as we saw in earlier works. This is one of the great masterpieces of the Carolingian Renaissance, Christ in Majesty, shown as a teacher seated on his throne. And then we have something like this, which is the it's in Flanders, actually, is a little quick sketch, and very beautiful quick sketches of illustrations in the book. We see a building boom. Charlemagne builds churches all over the Carolingian Empire, churches everywhere, and they're not just little tiny churches like we saw in Anglo-Saxon England. They're gigantic churches. This is a Carolingian church in Normandy. Here's another one that survives to this day. They're big, they're imposing, they're fortress-like. They're the first huge monumental buildings that we have in Europe, and here is the interior of one of those Carolingian buildings, churches. Again, these columns look very Roman, don't they? And one reason they look Roman is they were actually stolen from churches in Italy, and so that to make Roman columns, they put them in there. This is a wall painting that is characteristic of Carolingian art. Not very many wall paintings survive, but this is a very beautiful one from the Carolingian Empire that survives. Charlemagne built churches all over Europe, and you can see in this map the church centers all over Europe that he built monasteries and schools in every area of his kingdom. Okay, and here's one of the important things that happened in the Carolingian Empire is he standardized everything, and this is one of the characteristics of a Renaissance, that you have standardization of forms of various kinds, standardization of text, standardization of laws, laws are made for the whole kingdom, rules are made for the whole kingdom. In this case, he standardized the liturgy, and the liturgy is the music that's sung in the church. And the way they were learning music up to that time was to simply memorize it. And one generation of monks would teach the music to the next generation. But when Charlemagne tried to standardize it, it was too much for anybody to learn. And so for the first time, they started to write music down. And so now we have written music for the first time, and this is a page of written music. I know it doesn't look like music, but this is the very earliest of the music. They then developed it further so that later on they would write more than one line of music, and this Carolingian music was the origin of all Western music. Because they could write music down in lines that could be paralleled one to another, You have the development of harmony for the first time, of two melodies running at the same time, either in harmony with each other or counter to each other. And this is the basis of all Western music, all classical music, and all pop music, all modern music that we have today, because it could be written down, and this is all due to Charlemagne. Okay, here are some more historiated initials that show the great creativity of this Renaissance, creativity in these decorated initials. Under the grandsons of Charlemagne, the empire tended to disintegrate. The legacy of Charlemagne, was it feudal anarchy or feudal order? Louis the Pious was the only surviving son, and Charles the Bald, Louis the German, and the Emperor Lothar plunged the kingdom into civil war. And so you have the wars between all the grandsons of Charlemagne. Interestingly, they called in Danish mercenaries coming from Scandinavia, and these were Vikings. And these Vikings looked at the churches and they said, wow, they're full of gold and silver and jewels and beautiful manuscripts. We want them. And so we have the beginning of the Viking invasions. At the Treaty of Verdun in 843, France and Germany and the Middle Kingdom were created, dividing the Carolingian Empire up between the grandsons of Charlemagne. And the Treaty of Verdun in 843 was the first document written in both French and German and not in Latin. The result of the breakup of the Carolingian Empire was the Viking invasions. Here are the grandsons. Here's Charles the Bald, one of the grandsons of Charlemagne. Here is Lothar, or Louis the German, who was the Middle Kingdom. And here are the Vikings as they burst out of Scandinavia and attacked Europe from all different sides. And we'll come back to the Vikings later, but here are the invasions of Europe that you can see close up. They burst out of Europe and threw Europe into chaos. This is an imaginary picture of the Vikings, not a real picture, but this is how they're thought of. The responses in Europe were first the Ottonian Empire and then the Anglo-Saxon Empire, or the Anglo-Saxon Kingdom. This is the Ottonian Empire, this yellow portion of this map. The Germans first pulled themselves together as a result of these attacks, stood up against them, and created a new empire. Here is the ring seal of Otto the Great, the first of the Ottonians. And here is Otto the Second, his son, who is ruling a new and more literate empire governed by literate, educated clerks, bishops, who take over the government of the Ottonian Empire. Here is symbolically all the peoples of Europe doing homage, bowing their knee to Otto. This is the first one is the Slavs, the second is the Germans, the third is the Gauls or the French, and the fourth is Rome. So this picture shows all the kingdoms of Europe bowing the knee and doing homage to Otto as king of, as the emperor, the new emperor of the new empire. And so we have another Renaissance, the Ottonian Renaissance. And here you see this Ottonian art that draws on Carolingian art, and it's a new burst of creativity and literacy and education, centering now in Germany. Meanwhile, the Vikings completely conquered England, and here you see the Vikings attacking England, and here you see they completely conquer all of England, the north of Scotland and part of Ireland. So the Vikings take over England. The response to those invasions is Alfred the Great, and what he does is drive the Vikings out of England. This is Alfred's jewel, with a portrait of Alfred in the middle. And what happens is, just as in Germany, there is a Renaissance, another Alfredian Renaissance, in an English Renaissance in England as a result of Alfred the Great. First, Alfred builds burgs or fortifications all over England to fight off the Vikings. And these burghs then later grow into cities. They're places where people in the countryside can go to escape the invasions, and they end up being on the trade routes, and they become the new cities of England. He builds a navy for the first time in England, and the navy is used to fight off the Germans. And he sponsors a revival of literacy. He translates a lot of the classics of Latin into Anglo-Saxon. He begins the Anglo-Saxon Chronicle, which is then a history that's written year by year all over England. And so here is one of these manuscripts. But this Renaissance is different. Whereas the Ottonian Renaissance is all in Latin and the learned language of the church, the English Renaissance is done in Anglo-Saxon. And here's an Anglo-Saxon manuscript. Here are some more examples of this Renaissance that's going on in England. So, and there's a building campaign all over England, and we see churches built all over England. Okay, so now we have England in 626, and we see the all these Renaissances begun by Pope Gregory the Great as he missionized all of the Germanic states. Okay, let's take a little bit of a break, and we'll go to the east and see what happened with the arrival of Islam.
I forgot to tell you all. Yeah, but no, there were times when I had trouble understanding too. So it was either you have to really concentrate or to get past the first aspect. I had already read it because I went over and read it and helped him with it. And it was very, very good. Our seminar is on what he said was, the church is virtually paid in advance to the church. But when the church is coming up, it's going to be put under the control of the Lord, which is the church. The church is the church. And there are documents, where they actually written documents, which are a contract or agreement between the church and the Lord. It's going to put myself under the control.
Okay, here we are back from our break, and we spent the last time talking about the growth of Germanic Europe. Now we're going to turn to the East and look at Islam and the return of the Middle East and the growth of a culture in the East, the third era of Rome that we haven't looked at yet. We looked at the Germans, and let me add just a little bit about the Germans as we move into the Islamic area. Islam and Germanic Europe are growing at the very same time, and they're growing at the very same time that the Byzantine Empire was. They're the three heirs of Rome, and they're exactly simultaneous. Okay, so we have to go back and look at each one individually. I might mention women. Here are some Merovingian women. at this time, and scholars of women's history look at Germanic women as very free and equal, that they're very powerful women in both the Merovingian Empire and the Carolingian Empire. We see a great age of the freedom and the power of women. And so here are some more of these women who have a lot of influence in society. There's actually one Merovingian queen who is the power behind the throne of two of her sons and three of her grandsons, and she was just extremely powerful. She killed a lot of people and wielded power like any man would. And so the women are very powerful at this time. And there's some very beautiful pictures. We saw the Carolingian Renaissance and the growth, the explosion of culture during the time of Charlemagne, and the Carolingian Renaissance became the basis of the growth of European culture. And we mentioned the parenthesis: without Islam, there would be no Charlemagne. And it's certainly true that the Carolingian Renaissance is the foundation of the culture of Europe as it grows. And so we've seen the creation of that. And here are some more of the some of the typical artwork from the Carolingian Empire. These are ivories that are done in Carolingian time. Okay, the three heirs of Rome. Now we're going to deal with the third heir, and this is Islam. In this particular map, Islam is shown in the green area on this map. Okay, and we talked about a lot of renaissances that happened in the Germanic states and in the Carolingian Empire. Now we're going to talk about a Middle Eastern Renaissance, a revival of the Middle Eastern culture in a new form. And we remember our Mesopotamian culture with the Ziggurats. And again, we remember the environment, the geography of that area. And this is Mesopotamia, but Arabia looks pretty much like this too. And here we see a vast desert. And this is the region that we're going to talk about in the Middle East, where we have a lot of vast deserts. Okay, here is the Roman Empire, and Arabia, as you can see on that map, is not a part of the Roman Empire. The Holy Land is, but Arabia is not. And when we talked about the origins of Christianity, we mentioned that Jesus appeared in a backwater, in a corner of the empire that nobody cared about and nobody was paying any attention to. And Islam arose in the same kind of an environment, in a backwater like Palestine, in a place that nobody cared about and nobody was paying attention to. It was on the fringes, way outside the center of civilization. And often as we look at these various cultures, we will find that something new, anything new that's happening, that's growing, is usually on the edges of the culture. It's not in the middle, it's out on the edges where brand new innovations are happening. And this is the case with Arabia as well. And here we see this map. We have to recall also that Justinian, remember the empire of Justinian when he tried to reconquer the Roman Empire, and here we can see Justinian's conquests in yellow. And at that very time, Persia was revived. The Persian kingdom on that map was revived, and we have a great war between Justinian's general Belisarius and the Persian Empire. And remember that they exhausted each other in a great war, so that at the very moment when Islam arose, the two greatest powers in that region were the Byzantine Empire and the Persian Empire, and they had just slaughtered each other. They had exhausted each other completely in a great war. So this is the environment that Islam arose, and here they arose on the Arabian Peninsula, and here we can see it on our Eastern Hemisphere map, and here we see a close-up of the Arabian Peninsula. Arabia was a backwater, and it's a great desert, and caravan routes stretched across it, camels going across the desert, going from the two major cities, Mecca and Medina. Okay, Mecca and Medina were ruled by merchant princes, and they were city cultures ruled in a city government. But elsewhere in Arabia, there was tribal organization. And all over Arabia, there were Bedouin tribes that practiced a primitive animistic religion centered around the Kaaba. And the Kaaba was a black meteorite that had landed somewhere in there. And according to legend, it was the stone on which Abraham had attempted to sacrifice Isaac. But it has its origins much earlier than that in the animistic religions of the Bedouins. There were Christians and Jews also in Arabia. There were Coptics and Nestorian Christians in Yemen, and there were a lot of Jews there. And so Arabia was a place where a lot of different kinds of religions were all mixing together. It was in this environment that Muhammad appeared. And here we can see these Arabic nomads and Bedouins and camel herders ranging across the desert of Arabia with this tribal society. And the Arab merchant city dweller, here's an Arab merchant city dweller side by side with the Bedouins, were sophisticated city dwellers and merchants who profited from the caravan trade. Muhammad appeared in this environment and lived from 571 to 632, in the city of Mecca. Okay, let me see. Okay, this is the city of Mecca. I wanted to show you the city of Mecca. We'll come back to the city of Mecca because it's the holiest city of Islam, but here is the city as it was later. Muhammad lived from 571 to 632. In our lecture we just had, what was going on in Europe at that time? What else is going on? I've got it already written down. Just as Gregory's missionaries were setting out for England. This is also the time when St. Benedict was writing the Benedictine Rule, and Gregory the Great was Pope, just as he was sending his missionaries out for England and turning European culture toward the north. Okay. In 610, Muhammad had visions, and these were visions that were written down as the Quran, okay? He wrote these visions down, and the terms that come out of the writing of the Quran is a sacred book that is an uncreated book that has existed forever. It was uncreated, so it has always been in existence. Muhammad's visions that were written down were the Quran. The Ummah were the people of Allah, and Islam is the name of the religion, and the word Islam means surrender. We call the believers in Islam Muslims. It is not correct to call them Mohammedans, as we call Christians, because that would imply that people worship Muhammad, and he is not a god, he is a prophet. He is a bringer of the wisdom to the Muslims or believers. When Muhammad started preaching around Mecca, people didn't listen to him. There were rebellions, and he had to actually flee from Mecca and go to the city of Medina in 622. And this is called the Hijra. And 622 is the date of the beginning of the Muslim calendar, which commemorates his flight from Mecca to Medina. We might also mention that he was a merchant, and he was a young merchant who worked for more prosperous merchants. He ended up making his fortune by marrying a woman who was older than he was, and making his fortune in that way. He also had several other wives. He had more than one wife, and the youngest was supposed to have been his favorite wife. So the Hijra happens in 622, and he goes to Medina. When he got to Medina, he started preaching the Quran, the wisdom that he had obtained, supposedly dictated to him by the angel Gabriel. And he acquired a lot of followers and a lot of believers in Medina. He ended up taking over the whole city of Medina and taking his followers and then conquering Mecca. So by 630, he had conquered Mecca, and immediately he rallied a whole force behind him, and by 632, all Arabia was conquered. The slogan that was preached was, "There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet." The Muslim religion, and here we have, this is a picture of an Arab rushing around, conquering everything. "There is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet." Islam combines a lot of the elements of the Jewish religion and the Old Testament prophets, plus Jesus, who's regarded as a prophet, and it's a kind of combination of all of those different elements blended together in a very distinctively Arabic way. The Arabs were very good at poetry, and the Quran itself is very poetic. It reads like a great poem. The Quran was the word of God dictated by the angel Gabriel, an original uncreated book in heaven, and this means that every letter is sacred. Okay, if every letter is sacred, what does that mean? If the Quran is dictated by the angel Gabriel and every single letter is sacred, what does that mean? Yes.
Can't be translated or changed.
Excellent. You cannot translate it and you cannot change it. The Quran is organized in a very interesting way. If I can recall correctly, it's either that the longest book is first and it works down to the shortest. I think that's how it is, or it's the shortest first and it works to the longest, but I'm pretty sure the longest first, yeah. And so it's not organized according to subjects. Again, I said it's very poetic, and so it's this poetic wisdom according to how long each of the books is. It's the supreme law in religion and law and science and the humanities. The Quran is the central book to everything. It's supreme in every element of the society. Okay. Here's a passage from the Quran. Every letter is sacred, and this means that translation is a heresy. And it's also forbidden to make any graven images. Remember, the Old Testament says, "Thou shalt make no graven images." And it's taken in the Quran in a very extreme way that no images of God or Muhammad or human beings are to be made at all. So what does this mean to their art? If you cannot make any images, and this includes animals, you can't make images of living things. So what is this going to mean? What is their art going to be like? What's left? Well, part of their art is the script, the sacred letters of the Quran, and so a lot of the art is simply quotations from the Quran that are put on buildings or on manuscripts, and so this becomes part of the art. Then you're going to have mostly decorative things. You're going to have geometrical patterns. You're going to have squares and circles and triangles and zigzag lines and so on, and all geometric lines, and that's the kind of art we're going to say. There are five precepts of the faith, and these are often represented by the five fingers of your hand. Okay, and so here they are. What is this a sign of if you use your hand and your five fingers as the symbol of the sacred precepts of the faith? What does this suggest to you if you're using your hand as a symbol?
Protection.
It's a mnemonic device. This means it's a pre-literate society. They're not literate. And remember, we talked about the Ten Commandments. You use your 10 fingers to remember them. This is a pre-literate society. And here are the 5 precepts of faith. There's no God but Allah. And they are to live sober and upright lives. Pray towards Mecca 5 times a day. Ramadan is ritual fasting that takes place for 1 month a year. Pilgrimage to Mecca takes place once in a lifetime, and charity is giving alms to the poor. Okay. People are to live sober, upright, and solemn lives. Praying towards Mecca is done in the direction of Mecca. It's very interesting when you're in Muslim, or when I won't say all Muslim countries, but when I was in Malaysia and I would travel around and go to hotel rooms, there was always an arrow on the ceiling that pointed to the direction of Mecca, so you would always know what direction to pray in. The praying 5 times a day takes place at sunup and at meal times during the day and at sundown. And the call to prayer is very public. Islam is a very communal religion that emphasizes the unity of the community. And so the praying toward Mecca is usually done in a group. You go to a mosque or you go to a room and everybody prays together. As a group, they're called to prayer from the towers around the mosque, and often the call to prayer is done with a loud speaker, and it's done with a very loud chant. And so this is fine in Muslim countries. There are a lot of Muslims who live around Detroit and Michigan, and the neighbors often complain when the sun comes up and the call to prayer goes out over the whole city. But this is done in a very communal way. Men and women are separated. They do not pray together. And when you go into a mosque, the men are usually in the main floor, and they would pray in the center of the church. Women are put behind a screen and usually up on a balcony where they're out of the sight of the men. Ramadan is ritual fasting for an entire month of a year, and obviously they don't refrain from eating or drinking for the entire month because you'd starve to death, but it's fasting from sun up to sundown, and so that a meal is taken before the sun arises. The family might have a meal together, and then all day long they refrain from eating and drinking and smoking, and some people don't even swallow their saliva. They take it so seriously that they're not to have any nourishment whatsoever. And then when the sun goes down, after sundown, they might have a large family meal and a celebration with special ritual foods, you know, the same way that we might at a Thanksgiving dinner or something of that type. And it's a time of celebration. It's done as a religious ritual, so that the believers everybody takes part in it, but the believers will have the experience of what it's like to be poor and to be hungry. It's a way to make them attune to the suffering of those less fortunate, and so it's again, ritual fasting 1 month a year. It's the holiest month of the year, and it's ended with a great celebration after Ramadan is over. It's a feast that moves around in the year. It's a movable feast that happens at a different time every year because Islam operates on a lunar calendar, and so this is not the same as the solar calendar, so that Ramadan happens, I think, a little bit earlier each year, and so it can be at any time of year, usually a little bit earlier than the year before, so at different times every year. And it's not done in a modern way according to the calendar, but in many Muslim countries, Ramadan is only declared by the wise men of the town or the village where they're in, and the wise men, the oldest men, sit and they observe the rising of the moon every night, and when the moon reaches the exact right phase, then they announce it to the whole village or the whole town, Ramadan starts tomorrow. And it happens in different places. Ramadan might start in one country at a different time than another, depending on what the wise men of the town observe and when they announce that it's going to start. And they do the same thing when they announce it's going to end. And obviously it depends on where you live as to how you're affected by Ramadan. If you live on the equator, when days and nights are equal, Ramadan will be the same no matter what time of year it's in. But if you're a Muslim and you live in Sweden and Ramadan happens in the middle of the summer when the sun never sets, you're in big trouble. And there are a lot of Muslims in Sweden, by the way, which is and Norway, which is kind of interesting. The pilgrimage to Mecca, you're not required, but it's hoped that you will make a pilgrimage to Mecca once in your lifetime. And once you go to Mecca, you travel there, and it's a very great celebration to go. The pilgrims who go wear white clothing to signify that they're going on pilgrimage, and once they get to Mecca, they then go through a lot of rituals of marching around the city and going to sacred places in the city. They are issued and you're supposed to, in the middle of the pilgrimage, there's a post that represents the devil, and you're supposed to throw rocks at the devil, march around the Kaaba three times, and once you have completed your pilgrimage to Mecca, you're given a certificate to commemorate it, and you're entitled to wear a special hat that's a sign that you have actually been to Mecca. But if you're too poor to go to Mecca, you're excused from making that pilgrimage. But anybody who has the means to do it is very much encouraged to do it. Charity or alms to the poor is obvious, and this is a great requirement that there are a large number of charities within Islam that people give to because of this requirement. So those are the five precepts of Islam. There are a number of different elements that we might talk about that are also part of Islam. Jihad is one of the a well-known part of it, and the concept of jihad has changed rather drastically over the centuries. When it was first formulated, jihad was thought of as an internal struggle, a struggle with yourself to overcome the obstacles to being devout. Now, it has changed over time, and it's largely because of the Crusades, the European Crusades in Europe, that changed the concept of jihad to more of a holy war. It always had that connotation of a holy war, but it became a more overt holy war, very much more emphasized at the time of the Crusades of Europe, of going to the Holy Land. So jihad is the supremely meritorious activity. Service to the church and service to the state are identical, and in Islam, the church is the state. Everybody is under one ruler, the caliph, who is head of both church and the state. And religion is the law. The Quran is the law. There's another element of law, another code of law called the Sharia, which is an elaboration of the Quranic law. That the Sharia is applied to the daily life, and it's the often it's the law of Islam. Okay. Here is Mecca and the city of Mecca. The Kaaba has been incorporated into Islam, and the Kaaba is this building in the center of the city that you can see that is black. Here that's actually a black covering that's put over the Kaaba, but it's a building that encases the sacred meteorite that was part of the earlier ancient religion. interpreted in Islam as a meteorite stone on which Abraham agreed to sacrifice Isaac, and pilgrims who go to Mecca march around the Kaaba 3 times, and so you can see the city here. Here's the Kaaba, a close-up of the Kaaba with the pilgrims coming and marching around it. You can see it's covered with a kind of cloth. And so this is the best time of year to go on pilgrimage is during Ramadan. And so huge numbers of pilgrims go to Mecca during Ramadan. And often there are very tragic riots that are there when people try to cross bridges. There are too many people and they collapse, and there are always stories of that happening. But you can see in this drawing that there are huge crowds that all go to Mecca at the same time. Islam is a synthesis of Jewish, Christian, and Persian ideas. It adopts Jewish and Christian prophets. And in the original Islam, and hopefully Islam today, people of the book are tolerated, and people of the book are interpreted as Jews and Christians, who are thought of as people to whom God revealed elements of Islam before its completion with the revelations to Muhammad. And so Judaism and Christianity are looked at by Muslims as precursors to Islam, and Islam is seen as a more mature and complete revelation. They also incorporate elements of Zoroastrianism with the concepts of heaven and hell and right living according to a code of proper behavior. And this reminds us of Zoroastrianism, which is the old Persian religion incorporated into Islam. It has an element of Persian autocracy with the rule of the caliph, who rules both church and state in a very autocratic way. Interestingly, the position of women was elevated by Muhammad. He is looked on as freeing women from slavery and liberating them in a very great way. Although polygamy is still practiced, and these are probably Persian practices that were incorporated by Islam, but polygamy is still practiced. Muslims are allowed to have 4 wives. Muslim men are allowed to have 4 wives. Muslim women are not allowed to have multiple husbands. And the men are only allowed 4 wives if they can afford them. And so the rule is you have as many wives, up to 4, as you can afford, and a man is supposed to support each of these wives in an adequate sort of way, so that if he's very poor, he has to make do with 1 wife, and the wealthier he is, the more wives he can have, up to 4. The wives, and I'm familiar with the practices in Malaysia. It's quite interesting that the developments that I saw and that I came in contact with were that men would marry at different stages in their career, so that when they were first starting out their career, they would marry a young woman who was usually their equal, who would contribute to the family enterprise to make the man as wealthy as he could aspire to be and to further his career. And then as he reached a certain stage in his career, he might marry again a woman who would be wealthier and who would further his career even more. And this he would do up to 4 times as he would become wealthier. And hopefully he would be wealthy enough to situate each family in its own separate home. And they wouldn't necessarily have contact with the families together. This is how it worked in Malaysia. And I'm not sure how other countries work, but it was a very interesting concept. Divorce is possible, and divorce can be attained by either men or women, and all they have to declare is, I divorce you 3 times. They state, I divorce you 3 times, and they're able to have a divorce. Women are also entitled to property in the marriage if they have a divorce. And these are the elements that elevated women at the time that Muhammad preached. As time has gone on, we see in different Muslim countries that we often think of the women as being oppressed, being separated from men, being secluded in their houses and denied the same rights that men have. Often, when I've talked to Muslims, they will say that this segregation of women and limitation of women is often the consequence of pre-Muslim societies. For example, among the Bedouins, women were very much oppressed. And so often the oppression of women, Muslims attribute to local cultures as a local kind of thing and not necessarily part of Islam. There actually is a women's movement in Islam that I came in contact with in Malaysia. If you go through the Quran, you can see there are key texts that elevate the position of women. One that comes to mind right now is, if you do a kindness to a woman, you do a good thing. And there's a whole collection of texts from the Quran that praise and elevate and honor women. And there is a women's movement that emphasizes these and works for women's rights within Islam. The paradise in Islam, we mentioned a heaven and a hell. Paradise, interestingly, is very characteristically Arabian. It's an oasis or a garden, and so the garden is thought of as the Garden of Eden with the four rivers of paradise flowing together. And often these are seen in Persian rugs. Here's the promenade of the harem. A harem is a place where women are secluded, where there are multiple wives secluded in the harem. And here is a garden in a Persian rug. So if you look at a lot of Persian rugs that are done according to the principles of Islam, we have geometric kinds of art and symbols. We don't have any representation of human beings, but we might have plants and flowers. And so this is the great garden that a Persian rug would represent paradise. So that's interesting to know if you have Persian rugs. Islam was a militant religion, and remember that the entire Middle East was prostrated by the violent wars between the Byzantine Empire and the Persians, and so when Muhammad and his army burst forth, they conquered very quickly the entire Mediterranean and Middle Eastern region. By 630, the early conquest lasted from 632 to 655 over the prostrated area. In 636, Damascus and Jerusalem fell. In 640, Syria was occupied. 637 to 647, they went to the east and Persia was conquered, so they're spreading both east and west. In the 640s, Egypt fell. In 655, they entered the Mediterranean and Cyprus was controlled. And after this great bursting forth of great conquest to both east and west, then they stopped for a while. 655, we have a period of civil war that lasted from 655 to 661. And the Islamic world divided up into the Umayyad and the Fatimid factions, which are today the Sunnis and the Shiites. And here let's look at a couple of pictures. Here's the entrance of Omar the Great into Jerusalem, and as the Muslims conquered, they prided themselves in conquering by diplomacy and peace rather than violent conquest. For example, in Jerusalem, the city was surrendered without a battle, and Omar the Great entered Jerusalem and took it over. In Egypt, in the Byzantine Empire, there were a lot of quarrels going on within the church, a lot of disagreements, and Egypt fell rather easily and quickly because people were dissatisfied with some of theological decisions that the church had that the church had proclaimed in Egypt. Okay, here is the Mosque of Omar in Jerusalem, which is also called the Dome of the Rock and is still being fought over in Jerusalem. This is a great sacred church that's built mosque that's built on the site of a church that was built on the site of a Jewish sacred spot, and so this particular spot is sacred to Jews, Christians, and Muslims. So it's a site they all want, and still struggling over it. From 655 to 661, we have a period of civil wars, and the Muslims were divided into the Umayyad and Fatimid factions, which are today the Sunnis and the Shia. The Fatimids argued that the caliph must be the descendant of Muhammad. And at that time, Fatima, he had a surviving daughter, Fatima, and her husband claimed the throne. The Umayyads fought against that and declared, rather, that anyone, any holy person chosen by God could rule. As it ended up, the Umayyads were dominant everywhere but Egypt, and they took over the whole empire except for Egypt, which was ruled by the Fatimids. And at this time, when the civil wars were going on, the capital was moved to Damascus, and the Umayyads dynasty, the Umayyads ruled from 661 to 750 AD, of course. Okay, and here is Damascus, where the capital was moved to Damascus, from Mecca to Damascus, because it's a more central region, closer to Persia, which is really important. Here are the tombs of the caliphs in Damascus. They were ruling from Damascus. And here we see the extent of the Muslim empire at its fullest extent. It actually is longer, bigger than that, but at this time it's its fullest extent. Now, under the Umayyad dynasty, there were attacks on Constantinople from 750 to 680, and they were stopped by the secret weapon of the Byzantines, which was Greek fire. In 717 and 718, we have the last Arab attack on Constantinople because they more or less stopped attacking the Byzantines and gave up. But in 711, Visigothic Spain was conquered and it became one of the richest provinces of the whole empire. In the 730s, southern Gaul was invaded. And as we noticed last time, it was stopped by Charles Martel in 732 at the Battle of Tours. And I suggested to you that it's not really true that Charles Martel saved Europe from the onslaught of Islam. If you were a Muslim and you had a choice between the poverty-stricken, empty, backward lands of Gaul or France, and the Persian Empire, which one would you choose? They couldn't spread themselves thin forever, and so I think the Muslims chose Persia. They would have, if they had wanted to conquer Europe and Gaul, they would have done it. They could have. And so nothing really stopped them. Okay, so here's the extent of the Muslim Empire. This is a naval battle showing the use of Greek fire, and the Greeks are fighting off the Muslims in this battle. Here's in this map, you can see Mecca and Medina in Arabia. I've circled in red, and then the capital is moved to Damascus, which is in more of the central region of the lands they conquer. You can see Damascus there to the north. Arabic was a universal language, and within one generation, the leaders of the Muslim Empire were Persians. Okay, the Arabs ruled over the rest of them only for one generation, and Persian learning and knowledge and expertise rose to the top of the social pyramid very quickly. And one reason this happens is because under Islam, all believers are equal before God. And so it doesn't matter where you're from in the entire Islamic empire. If you're a Muslim, everybody is equal. And there's complete social mobility. You can rise to the top. So no matter what ethnic identity you are, you can rise to the top in Islam. The Greek and Roman and Persian classics were blended together, and a very high culture developed very quickly. Islam was transformed to Syriac, from Arab to Syriac and Persian. It's an empire, like the Roman Empire, it was eclectic, and there was a synthesis of all of these different cultures. Islam was ruled as a Pax Islamica, and the trade routes, and especially Islam is a very mercantile society. Merchants are the key element in Islam, and they developed all kinds of institutions that that helped the flow of trade from one end of the empire to the other. And the banking institutions that later were transferred to Europe were actually developed first by Islam, so that you could write a check in Spain and you could cash it in Damascus. And there were holding companies and trading companies developed so that you could go from one end of the empire to another and still have your business connections from one end to another. Remember that we said that you can't translate the Quran. So what this means is that Arabic becomes the universal language, and everybody spoke Arabic. It's the lingua franca, you might say, of the Islamic Empire, just as Latin was the key language in the Roman Empire, and Chinese became the key language in the Han Empire. Arabic tied it all together. We can speak of a Pax Islamica, the culture of the Pax Islamica, which preserved Greek and Roman and Persian classics. And the pattern is very much the same as in the Roman Empire. Remember, in the Roman Empire, we had a veneer of Latin and Greek culture that spread over all the conquered people. And the same is true in the Islamic Empire. There's a veneer of Arabic culture that spreads over everyone. But because of the equality of believers, the native cultures rise to predominate. It's an eclectic culture, and it's synthetic. There's a synthesis of all these different elements, Greek, Roman, Syriac, and Persian elements. And we have a great flowering of science, largely because of the background of Greek and Persian and Babylonian, Mesopotamian science. We now have science blossoming throughout the Arabic world. Algebra, they excel in astronomy. Algebra, in fact, is an Arabic world. They invented algebra. Greek medicine was preserved and improved upon. And there's a flowering of art that combines Persian, Roman, Greek, and Arabic elements. Islam itself was transformed from Arabic to Syriac to Persians. Trade is the basis of the empire. Trade is a merchant society. Trade is the most important. And one of the main characteristics of the Islamic empire is slavery. Slavery was extremely predominant, and it was a fundamental part of the whole Islamic society. And this is true to this day. If you look at Arabic culture in Arabia and in Lebanon, in the various states of the Persian and Arabic world, slavery still is practiced. And once in a while we'll find an article in the newspaper today of slavery being practiced in America, and being discovered, because slavery is still, there are remnants of it that are still there. Here's the Alhambra. I'm going to show you some of the art and architecture. The Alhambra is in Spain. It's one of the masterpieces of Islamic art. See the building here? Here's the inside. It is absolutely glorious, beautiful art. We might notice some of the elements that we've seen before. We have slender and elegant Greek columns. We have Roman arches now extended in a more elaborate horseshoe kind of arch. The walls are covered with Roman mosaics, which have now attain a great brilliance. And then we see Persian lace-like domes and arches above the windows. You can see that sort of lace-like decorations. Notice the arch in the very front is an elongated pointed arch, which is very typical of Islam. And so you can see these Roman elements and these Persian elements and Greek elements all blending together in a richer new culture. We might look at the fountain in the middle, again, the waters of paradise. And so we see the elements of Islam translated into the architecture. This is the center of a mosque, and again, paradise is a garden. One of the things we see with these columns are symbolic palm trees, so that in the center of the mosque, with all the columns and the tops to the columns, the capitals, are symbolic palm trees, so that you're in a garden when you're in the mosque, representing paradise. Again, and here is the Alhambra. Again, these are some of the gardens and the corridors of the Alhambra, and you can see this elaborate Muslim art, this very gorgeous art. This is a building that still exists today. This is a drawing, of course. Note the elaborate geometric design, the horseshoe arches, geometric design. Again, we have to remember that there's not supposed to be any human representations. And Arabic poetry still practiced a predominance, and we see a poet at the with a guitar player at the forefront. Okay, here is some of this geometric design that we see on all of the mosques that we're looking at. We see geometric design at the top, and at the bottom you see geometric design combined with floral design with sayings from the Quran script that are written into it. And so this is very typically Muslim. Here is the court of the Mosque of Touloun in Cairo, and we see many of those same elements that we saw in the Alhambra, but you know, somewhat different. They don't slavishly copy, but we see the same styles. Notice the coffered roof, which is very much like the Roman kind of ceiling that you might see in a Roman church, and this is adopted in this church. And here is the Mosque of Muhammad Ali. I'm sorry, I'm forgetting where that is. I think it's in Egypt. But this is a typical mosque with its slender, graceful minarets at each corner of the mosque where the call to prayer would be done. The Roman dome is adopted. All of those domes were originally invented by the Romans, and so they're incorporated into this style of architecture. And here is a Moorish doorway in Cordoba on the right, where you can see again the elaboration and of the arch into even a more circular form, geometric elements on a door on the left. And here is yet another mosque. I think this one is in India, and so that the Muslims then spread farther to the east, conquered India, spread all the way across India, and all the way to, by the 14th century, they were in Indonesia and Malaysia, all the way to Asia. And this is Indian. I'm pretty sure this building is Indian. And now combining elements of Indian culture. A traveling dervish of Khorasan is part of the mixture of Indian culture, which is now mixed into this rich cult mixture of all the different cultures. The Abbasid dynasty ruled from 762 to 1055, and at this point the capital of the Muslim empire was shifted even farther eastward to Persia in Baghdad. And again, the empire was becoming even more Persianized. There was a Eurasian-wide commercial network from Scandinavia to Malaysia and Indonesia, from Spain to Africa and India. The very height of Islamic culture was under Harun al-Rashid from 786, who ruled from the House of Wisdom in Baghdad. And somewhat after that time, the title of the ruler was changed from Caliph to Sultan in 950. At around this time, we see a great cultural flowering and renaissance in Spain. And Avicenna is and Averroes are the two most prominent scholars who are practicing in Spain. Avicenna was a Renaissance man who was a great figure in literature and science and as a diplomat. He was a man who was skilled in all fields, lived from 980 to 1037, and he's thought of as the height of culture in Spain at that time. Under the Muslims in Spain, there was a great flowering of Jewish culture, and the Jews flowered, and this is the time when great Jewish philosophers like Maimonides were writing in Spain, and we see a rich blending of those cultures together, which we wish could still go on today, with the toleration and the sharing between the Muslim and the Jewish and the Christian culture in Spain. It was a model of tolerance and sharing and cooperation. And here we see the shift of the capital, and Damascus is in red, Baghdad is in purple, again shifting ever eastward. Persia becomes really the center of the Muslim empire at this time. Okay. In 1055, we see, though, an invasion of the Muslim Empire, and these are some pagan, I guess you would call them non-Muslim Seljuk Turks, who come charging into the Muslim region. They're quickly converted to Islam. They're Turkic nomads from the plains of Central Asia. They're the same people invading the Chinese Empire at that very time. Turkic nomads, they convert to Islam. What they do is shatter the unity of the Islamic world, just as they shattered the unity of the Chinese world, and at other times we had seen them already invading Europe as well. The Grand Sultan is now a Turk, and he rules a confederacy rather than a unified empire. And the Turks who come into this region have the zeal of new converts. The Battle of Manzikert in 1071 was a battle between the Seljuk Turks and the Byzantines, and the Byzantines were defeated. And at this time, they're terrified that the Turks are going to conquer the Byzantine Empire. So the Byzantines then appeal to the West, they appeal to the Pope, and here we see the great Seljuk Empire moving into that empire. We have nomads in Arabia, and we have the red area is the Seljuk Empire, the Fatimids are the green area to the south, the green area to the north are Danish Medes who are Muslims, and pink area are the Seljuks of Rome. They actually call it Rome, but the colored areas are the areas dominated by Muslims, and the Turks are all in the east. Okay, the only non-Turkish peoples left are in Arabia, in Egypt, and the Berbers in North Africa and Spain. Okay, but the Seljuk Turks really disrupt this Muslim world. Okay, in 1095 to 1300, they are overrun, they are not overrun, but they are invaded by the Crusades. With the appeal of the Byzantines to the West, we have the preaching of the First Crusade by Pope Urban II in 1095. And this happens in the lands of France. And the reason that Urban preaches the crusade in France is because the yellow part here is the Ottonian Empire. Remember, we talked about the Ottonians and the German Empire. And so the German Empire is very unified, and the king is very strong and powerful. But in France, France is broken up into a lot of little individual counties. France rather fell apart because of the Viking invasions. And so France is not unified, which is exactly why Urban II went to France to preach the First Crusade, because there was no king to stop him from assembling an army to go and conquer Jerusalem, which is what he intended to do. And here on the left you see the preaching of the First Crusade. On the right is the preaching of the Second Crusade. And so we have waves of crusaders, successive wave after wave after wave of crusaders going to the Holy Land, wanting to reconquer Jerusalem. Only the First Crusade was successful, because the Arab world, or the Muslim world, was so shattered by the Seljuk Turks. The First Crusade was able to conquer the Holy Land, and here we see a crusader setting off on crusade to conquer. And here we see departure of other crusaders in their ships to sail across the Mediterranean to the Holy Land. And here are the routes that the crusaders took. They weren't unified, they weren't organized, they didn't do it very well, but they did conquer the Holy Land. Here are all the different waves that went at different times, some of them going across the sea and some of them going by land and through Asia Minor. The First Crusade conquered a ring of states in the Holy Land. You can see Edessa in yellow in the north, Antioch, Tripoli, and the Kingdom of Jerusalem in pink. It's an illusion that the Crusades were a success. They were a great failure. The only one that succeeded was the First Crusade. They conquered the Holy Land, and then everyone went home. And so there was practically nobody left to hold on to it. And so those crusader states that only lasted 100 years, the Muslims threw them out very quickly, within one generation, under the leadership of Nur ad-Din and Saladin. The Muslims rallied and they threw the crusaders out in only 100 years. So the crusades were a great failure. And although more and more crusades came again and again trying to reconquer the Holy Land, they failed and they were thrown out. But in that 100 years they were there, they built typical medieval castles all over the Holy Land. And here you see the most famous, Croque de Chevaliers. And this is the most famous of the Crusader castles. The best Crusader castles, the best castles in the world are today in the Holy Land, if you want to go see castles. Go to Lebanon, Syria, Turkey, and you see these Crusader castles that are remnants of the Crusader settlement, but they only lasted 100 years. Two of the great heroes of the Crusade were Richard Lionheart, and here is a real portrait of him on his coin, and Saladin, who were the two great champions who fought each other. Here is Saladin. This isn't a real picture. It's just an imagined picture of what Saladin looked like. And they fought each other to a standstill. It was Saladin who really threw the crusaders out and never to return. They were completely limited. Here are some Turkish arms from the crusade that you can see are quite different from the European arms. And here are the routes of the crusaders to the Holy Land after all of the crusaders were thrown out. If you look along the shore of the Holy Land, that orange region there, they have just a toehold on the Holy Land after Saladin. And so the crusader states are gone. They just have a little toehold along the coast, And within another 100 years, they were thrown out of that as well. So the Crusades were a great failure, and it makes you wonder why in the modern world there's such an outcry against the so-called Crusaders from the West. The Crusades traumatized the Muslim world in a way that's totally out of proportion to their success, because they were a failure. But what it did was to mobilize the Muslim world into a new concept of jihad. And this is when the concept of holy war gets very, very strong in the Muslim world, okay, as a result of the Crusades. And here are some more Crusaders. This is a naval battle. Interestingly, the technology of war grew enormously at this time. Both sides developed new war technologies of siege machines of various kinds. Here's a battle going on. Here are more Crusaders going, and the word crusade comes from taking the cross, and here is a Crusader coming, the Crusaders coming on foot, carrying a cross. Here, there's an exchange of culture and castles and feudal courtesy. And one of the interesting things, I showed you Saladin and Richard Lionheart, and they're both chivalrous, courteous warriors who share a very common culture of showing deference to each other and respecting their honor and fighting according to the rules of courtesy and chivalry. And so we see that in that there's an exchange of cultures. The Muslims become more like the Christians, and the Christians become more like the Muslims. And we're seeing this over and over again as we see cultural exchanges going on. Here's the siege of a Muslim castle by the Crusaders. The Crusaders are thrown out of the Holy Land, and so they settle in the islands of the Mediterranean. And here's the Crusader Kingdom of Rhodes that was actually run by the Hospitallers. The military orders were a result of the Crusades. The Knights Templar and the Knights Hospitallers were two of the important military orders. They're kind of like monks on horseback who fought in a celibate way. They took the vows of monkhood while they were fighting battles. There was a setback in the East in 1204 with the conquest of Constantinople. The Crusaders turned against the Christians. I mean, when they couldn't win the Holy Land, they conquered Constantinople, and they held the Latin states in the East for a time. But by 1295, the Crusaders were completely driven out of the Holy Land, and so the Crusades were a massive failure. Although this Kingdom of Rhodes lasted until the 18th century, but it's not in the Holy Land. It's an island in the Mediterranean. Okay. Meanwhile, in Spain, the Reconquista was progressing forward, and that was a huge success. The Christians were able to drive the Muslims out of Spain. Here's some Muslim art, and here is the Muslim Spain. I'm going to show you a series of maps. The Reconquista began in about 1000. You see knights, there were some remnants, the kingdoms of Castile and Leon in the north of Spain were never conquered by the Muslims, and so the Christians had a foothold in the north of Spain. French knights poured into the north as the Crusades began. When the Crusades were going on in the Holy Land, there was a great fervor in Europe to drive the Muslims out of Spain, and so a lot of Crusaders went into the north of Spain. And we're going to see in a series of maps that slowly the Muslims were pushed out of Spain. So here is Spain in 1030 with the formulation of the kingdoms of Castile and Leon and Aragon in the north of Spain. And here we move 100 years later in 1210. You can see that the Muslims, who are the orange here, are being pushed farther and farther south, with more Christian kingdoms forming in the north. And here in 1360, you see the pushing, and all those dots there are actually military orders, the Knights Templar, their bases there, and they become very active in Spain, and the formation of Castile and Aragon and Portugal, as the Muslims are pushed farther and farther south. They only have a toehold there in Granada, and by 1492, they're completely pushed out. Meanwhile, there are more invasions of the Muslim Empire from the east, and this huge invasion is of the Mongols, yet another tribe of nomads from Central Asia, and the Mongols just explode with lightning speed. The pink area is their first conquest, the conquest of Genghis Khan, stretching all the way from China all the way into Europe, and then the orange part are the successors of Genghis Khan, who conquer even farther into Europe and into southern China and all the way into the Muslim lands in Arabia and in Asia Minor and Turkey. The yellow part is Timur's conquest of India. And so we'll do a whole lecture on the Mongols. But what this did was to shatter the Islamic world. The conquest of the Mongols absolutely shattered the Muslim unity, and I believe that this is the point where Islam lost its tolerance and its eclecticism and its ability to have this rich and inclusive civilization. It turned in upon itself and became very limited at this point. I think the terror of the Mongols, who conquered Baghdad and Russia and all of those regions that used to be dominated by Islam. It was yet another wave of invaders from Central Asia. Well, here are some Mongols. We'll look at some Mongols and we'll see them later. Again, nomads who sweep into the Islamic world. In the West, the Mongols were converted to Islam, and the Muslims conquered India at this time, and we have a new cultural synthesis blending together Mongols and Islam and Indian culture. From India, Islam spread to Indonesia and Malaysia around 1400, and you can see India included into this empire and of the Islamic world. And the red circled region is Malaysia and Indonesia, which remains Muslim to this day. And so that the Muslim world spread all that way into Asia. Part of the Philippines, I should have included a little bit to the north, that part of the Philippines were also Muslim. And here's the Great Mosque at Delhi, again, Muslim architecture in Delhi in India, a classical Islamic piece of architecture, but now we have those onion-shaped domes that are more characteristic of Mongol culture, and now we see them in India. We see similar architecture in Russia, where the Mongols captured. And this is, again, some Indian architecture very creatively expanding the elements of Islamic culture and incorporating them with Indian culture. And, of course, the Taj Mahal is a result of this great conquest in Agra in India. The Taj Mahal is a mosque. And it has one of those sort of onion domes on the top of it. More nomads then swept in from Central Asia, and these are the Ottoman Turks. They were nomads from the plains of Central Asia, sweeping in. Well, the Mongol Empire fell apart very quickly in one generation after on the death of the last of the Mongol rulers, and survived only in China, which we'll see later. And so then they were displaced by another wave of Turks. These are the Ottoman Turks, and they swept in and convert to Islam. They swept into the Holy Land and converted to Islam. The white region on this map is the new Ottoman Empire that was conquered at this time. Constantinople fell in 1453 to the Ottoman Turks, and that was the end of the Byzantine Empire. The Turks reached all the way into Europe. If you look at that map, you can see this is the origin of the Muslims in Macedonia and in Bosnia. This is the time when the Turks settled in those regions and brought with them Islam. And so here you can see the fall of Constantinople in 1453 and the Ottoman Empire, which is right here. The Ottoman Turks went all the way to Vienna. Meanwhile, another group of Muslims arose in Egypt. Mamluks, who were a slave dynasty that arose and took over the Muslim kingdom of Egypt and spread to Arabia and the Middle East. This was a slave dynasty that originated from the Caucasus, and they were enslaved and converted to Islam, and they took over the Egyptian Fatimid kingdom. Okay, by 1492, the Muslims were expelled from Spain, and here we see the new kingdoms of Spain. The Muslims were driven out of Granada in 1492. And because of the great, and we'll go back to that map, because of the great effort, the crusading effort to drive the Muslims out of Spain, you have this fervent missionary activity and conversion and expansion activity going on in Spain, which transferred to the discovery of the New World and conditioned the Spanish for the conquest of the New World, which can be looked at as a crusade extended as they moved out of Europe. Okay, we have done a quick thumbnail sketch of the Muslim world, bringing it up to the end of our period, where we end in 1500, this course. Next time, we're going to move to the north and look at another great wave of migration. We're going to look at the Vikings and see how they impacted not only the European world, but the Asian world as well. So next week, we'll do the Vikings. See you then.